Tension had been building before the start of World War I. It was all waiting for a spark to ignite a chain of events that would start the Great War. That all came to a head when Archduke Ferdinand, heir to the Austro-Hungarian throne, was assassinated along with his wife Sophie by 23-year-old suburban national Gabrielo Princip on June 28, 1914. He wanted to end the Austro-Hungarian rule over Bosnia and Herzegovina. Austria blamed the Serbian government for the assassination, and rightly so. The issue was that Serbia was supported by Russia, and Austria wanted to make sure that before they declared war on Serbia, they had the assurances of the German government that they would support them. Once they had those assurances, Austria declared war on Serbia, and of course, Russia came to their aid. Then Germany declared war on Serbia and their ally France. When Germany crossed through Belgium to attack France, Great Britain called this a violation of Belgium's neutrality and also declared war on Germany. For the first time in history, the entire world had taken sides except for the United States. The United States decided they were going to stay neutral. Woodrow Wilson stated it was a war which we have nothing to do. Now, that all changed in the spring of 1917 when America declared war on Germany. And at the time, it was about 20,000 black soldiers in military uniform. That was about to change with the passage of the Selective Service Act, which removed the quota for black soldiers in the military based on their population. This prepared the war effort for an influx of black soldiers and was a part of the buildup towards World War I. The War Department decided to establish 16 training bases, one of which being Camp Logan in Houston, which we spoke about in the first episode, episode one of season one, about the Houston riots of 1917. Welcome to One Mic. I'm your host, Country Boy. This is a Black History Podcast. We're here today to discuss the Harlem Hellfighters, which is a very interesting topic. It covers the 15th National Guard Regiment, also known as the 369th Infantry. They fought for France during World War I and spent more time in combat than any other American regiment during World War I. It's a wonderful topic. Thank y'all for listening. If you enjoy this, please consider donating to my Patreon page so I can continue to bring you great content. In the aftermath of the Houston riots, the consensus in the North was that the mutiny was a direct result of Jim Crow laws in the South, and they blamed the military for placing black soldiers in Houston to start with. Most of the South agreed with that idea, and that sending blacks into the hell that was Houston during Jim Crow was a mistake. Some even sent delegations to Washington to protest that practice. They also expressed fear that a large number of black troops in local military camps would terrorize the surrounding population. As we've seen with the War Department at the time was going to do what they were going to do. And they did. They continued to send black troops into training camps all over the United States. Now, at the time, we ramp up to the war. There were some questions among black leaders that the black brothers should sit out this war effort. They felt that they considered their status in America, that black soldiers would fight for the American way, felt like a mockery. The Boston Guardian, which was a local paper in black neighborhoods in Boston, wrote that we believe in democracy, but we hold that this nation should enter the list with clean hands and demand that no black man should be put in uniform until this government renounces all forms of racism. On the other side of that coin, some black leaders felt like it was in their best interest of patriotism to fight alongside in this war. Black men should answer the call of the nation and prove their loyalty and bravery, and they should earn the right to be treated as full citizens and that segregation can wait. A good war record would advance their cause more than any strike ever would. Now, the idea of an all-black regiment in New York was the idea of a black man by the name of Charles W. Fillmore. But the pride and joy of the 15th was Colonel William Haywood, who was a white lawyer. He was a captain in the Spanish-American War and commanded black troops, and their bravery left a long-lasting impression on him. Later, when he was promoted to colonel in the Nebraska National Guard, he moved to New York and became a partner in a law firm. This led to him becoming an assistant district attorney for the DA and soon-to-be governor, Charles Whitman. Whitman was elected governor, and he took Haywood with him to Albany to serve as his chief counsel. That level of closeness allowed him to get approval for the 15th New York Infantry, and he was able to convince Whitman to approve the 15th by drawing on his experiences dealing with black soldiers during the Spanish-American War. Once the dream was realized, he even made Charles Fillmore a captain in the 15th. The 15th started with 200 Harlem veterans from the Army, and they started recruiting and formed 10 companies of 15 men each. That grew from 200 to 650 to 1,300, which was enough to be recognized by the federal level. Once they were up to wartime strength with 1,900 soldiers, that meant the regiment was no longer made up of Harlem natives. So they decided that they were going to divide up the battalion into four companies, the first being Manhattan, the second being Brooklyn, and the third being a mix of Manhattan and the Bronx. The regiment struggled with proper uniforms and rifles to drill with. The men used the clothes on their back and broomsticks as weapons. It took more than 3 years for them to be able to get proper equipment. Once America entered the war on April 6, 1917, by July, the 15th Regiment left New York for formal Army training. The regiment was shipped to Camp Wadsworth in Spartanburg, South Carolina. As you would expect, it didn't receive a warm welcome by the locals. The locals felt like it was their place to teach these black New Yorkers their place. The Chamber of Commerce even filed a protest with the governor of New York, stating the most tragic consequences would follow the introduction of the New York Negro with Southern ideas into a community, into the community life of Spartanburg. The 15th was tested almost immediately after Noble Sissel, who was the regiment's drum major, walked into a local hotel and was asked to remove his hat. He didn't move his hat quickly enough because both of his arms were full. That prompted the manager to swing, knock his hat off. As Sissel bent down to pick it up, the manager kicked him in his ass and kicked him out the door. The rest of his bandmates saw what had happened and seek to get revenge and were only stopped by Lieutenant James Reach Europe, who held rank and ordered him to attention. The next night, a group of soldiers assembled at the gate of Camp Wadsworth and announced they were going to shoot up Spartanburg. This time, Colonel Haywood was on hand and talked them down. He also understood that this was an issue that was not going to go away. So he went to Washington and met with Secretary of War Newton D. Baker, and they sent the Secretary Assistant for Negro Affairs back to Spartanburg with Haywood to investigate. The men voiced their bitterness they felt for the insults that had been passed their way as they went through town, but expressed willingness to listen because of everything that was at stake. The War Department, rather than let the soldiers continue to face the hardships in Spartanburg, decided to ship them back to New York and then to France. Their combat training had barely even started on October 16th, when under strict secrecy, the 15th was shipped back to Harlem and then taken to Hoboken, New Jersey, where they set sail for Europe, or so they thought. After 2 days at sea, the ship broke and they had to come back to port. A month later, on November 12th, they set sail for Europe on the Pocahontas, and a fire broke out before they were even able to leave the port. Then, on December 3rd, they set sail again, and the ship collided with another ship during a blizzard. The collision left a huge 10-foot hole right above the waterline. The men volunteered to repair because they had no desire to go back to Hoboken. The 15th Regiment got off to an unlucky start, and it would take a bit more luck to get them into combat. When they landed in Brest, France on December 27th, after their transfer to St. Nazarene, the troops spent most of their time building rail yards, preparing roads, and unloading ships. It wasn't long before they asked the officers, "When do we get to fight?" Soon after that, they were sent to Coquedan in Brittany, which was an artillery camp. They thought that this would be their first opportunity to see some action, but as it turns out, it was also served as a prisoner of war camp, and they were just there to guard the German prisoners. Colonel Haywood attempted to plead his case with General John J. Pershing, who was the commander of the American Expeditionary Force. The general was never going to consider the idea of an all-black regiment in his army, but he did offer to attach them to the French High Command under the 369th Regiment Infantry of the United States. They were still under the United States Infantry, but their orders would come from French officers. And the first orders were to report Gouverneur d'Arcon for formal transfer and training in the French Army. While Americans had a lot of reservations about black soldiers in combat and mostly used them as laborers and stevedores, the French Army knew exactly what they were getting and were pleased with the idea. They had used black troops for almost a century, and by the time America entered the war, France had a black general and four black colonels. They were all part of the Bataillons d'Afrique, or as the rest of the army called them, the Happy Ones. Based on their experiences with black troops, the French were more than happy to accept American black troops. And being on assignment in the French army worked out well for the 369th also, because American troops were short on war supplies. As the United States continued to ramp up their war effort, Americans arrived in the spring, but in France, it was still cold and snowy, and they were without winter uniforms. The 369th had no such issues because their uniforms were well-suited to war, and they even had boots, something that was almost impossible to come by for American troops at the time. Also, the food was much, much better. The American rations were of good quality, but they had a shortage of mess sergeants who could turn this into something edible. While the French didn't have the rations, they took cooking seriously and their food tasted much better as a result. During that training, the 369th was set up into separate groups of 120 to train in school where they learned how to use French weapons. The French troops were shocked at how quickly they mastered French because the white American troops didn't bother to learn it at all. After that training was completed, they were sent to the front lines to learn trench warfare and raiding. So what they did was they sent them in small groups of battle as battle observers. It wasn't long before they were sent into their first action at Bordeaux, France. The regiment was responsible for holding a section of the line that had been abandoned by French troops that had mutinied months earlier. It was a complete sink or swim operation. There would be no hand-holding on this assignment. And while they suffered heavy losses, the 2 months they spent on the front, they performed amazingly well. On November 1st of 1918, the 369th joined the French attack on Bourgogne Wood. The weather was awful. It was cold and wet. The troops were able to advance 11 miles, and by November 3rd, they had captured the rail line and had stopped the Germans from retreating. They were closer to Germany than any other Allied army. The Allies allowed the Germans the chance to make an organized retreat so they could get supplies up to their lines. But by December 1st, the Allied armies had crossed over into Germany, and the French troops allowed the 369th the honor of being the first to set foot on enemy turf. One of the best stories among the 369th was the day of fighting among the Belleau Woods in 1908. The 369th was under a counterattack, and their French officer had called for a retreat. Colonel Haywood said, "Turn back." "I say we won't. We're going through there or we ain't coming back." And he led his men in the fire. The French officers attempted to wave him off, but Haywood told them, "My men never retire. We go forward or we die." Private Elmer McCowan won the Distinguished Service Cross for fighting. In an interview, he told reporters, "On September 26th, the captain asked me to carry dispatches. The Germans pumped machine gun bullets at me all the way, but I made the trip and back safely. I was sent out again. And as I started with the message, the captain yelled at me, 'Bring back a can of coffee.' He was joking. I didn't know that at the time. Being a foot messenger, I had some times ducking German bullets, and those bullets seemed very sociable, but I didn't care to meet up with them. So I kept right on traveling in high gear, and none of them touched my skin, though some of them came pretty close. On the way back, it seemed like the whole war had turned. One bullet passed through my trousers and made me hop, skip, and jump pretty lively. I saw a shell hole about 6 feet deep, and I dented it another 6 feet when I plunged into it hard. In my fist, I held the captain's can of coffee. When I climbed out of the shell hole and started running again, a bullet clipped a hole in the can and made the coffee start spilling out. I turned around, stopped for a second, looked Kaiser right in his face, held up my can of coffee with my finger plunged in the hole to show the Germans that they were fooled. And just then another bullet hit the can and another finger that acted to stopgap. It must have been good luck to save my life because bullets were picking at my clothes and so many hit that can that all my fingers were hugged to keep the coffee in. As I jumped in the shell holes and wiggled along the ground and back to safety, and what did you think? When I got back to safety in my own trench, I stumbled and spilled the coffee. And Private Elmer McCowan wasn't even the most famous member of the 369th. That honor belonged to Henry Johnson. On the night of May 14, 1918 in Argonne Forest, Private Henry Johnson and Private Needham Roberts were on sentry duty at midnight. It was about 4 a.m. Johnson heard the almost inaudible clicking sound of wire cutters. This is when Johnson fired up a flare to light up the battlefield. When he did this, German soldiers tossed hand grenades at the two soldiers and showered them with shrapnel. Roberts was badly wounded and pinned down in the trench. Johnson tossed grenades back at the German soldiers, but it was so many of them they quickly reached the rim of the foxhole. He grabbed his rifle, but with only three bullets, he fired and missed twice before hitting one of the Germans in the chest. He then used his rifle as a baseball bat and to beat the other German to death until it splintered. At this point, Germans had attempted to take Private Roberts as a prisoner. Armed only with a bolo knife and with three bullet wounds, he attacked the Germans and stabbed one of them in the head. He was rushed by a second man who managed to shoot Johnson with a fourth time before he was able to stab him in the stomach. At this point, reinforcements arrived and Johnson was taken to a field hospital. Johnson was able to kill four Germans and wound 20 more. The entire French force lined up to see Johnson and Roberts receive the French Croix de Guerre, which is French's highest honor for battlefield bravery. It was also the first time that an American had been awarded this award. In Johnson's award had been included the Golden Palm, a symbol of extraordinary valor, which is rarely given. When he returned home from World War I, he had over 21 injuries, and his discharge papers made no mention of his injuries. So the Johnson was denied his Purple Heart and his disability. That didn't stop the Army from using Johnson's image to recruit soldiers. Theodore Roosevelt even called him one of the five bravest Americans. But by the mid-20s, until the time of his death in 1929, he had all but been forgotten. He was unable to hold a job down because of his injuries. His foot had been shattered. He began to drink, and then his wife left him. He died alone and destitute in 1929. Henry Johnson was able to see the recognition in death that he never received in life. In 1996, he was awarded his Purple Heart. And in 2001, a data entry error was found to have him listed under a William Henry Johnson and that he was, in fact, had been buried in Arlington Cemetery. And lastly, in June 2nd of 2015, he was awarded the Medal of Honor, the United States' highest and most prestigious military decoration, which is awarded to U.S. military servicemen who distinguished themselves with acts of valor after 191 days of combat, more than any other American regiment in World War I, the 369th. The 369th never had a man captured while capturing over 300 Germans and killing and wounding countless more. They paid a heavy price for their bravery, with over 200 of them being killed and 800 wounded. But they completely earned their nickname of Hellfighters bestowed onto them for bravery and their bitter fighting. When the Hellfighters arrived back in New York, journalists and politicians seemed to only have great things to say about the 369th and African-American troops in general. It felt like they had turned a corner in racism. And after the war, many black troops felt like the attitude had changed and they couldn't have been more wrong. Whites in the South were aware of the taste of decency that the black troops had experienced in France, and they knew they weren't going to hold still for that kind of treatment they had experienced before the war. They also felt that they had no reason to change their attitude.
In the following months, over the summer of 1919,
the violence in what would be called the Red Summer, hundreds of blacks, many of them black soldiers, were killed because of the threat to Jim Crow and racial subjugation. It was like the war never happened. What did change was their mindset. Before the war, many of them just resigned to the fact that this is the way the world was. After the war, they came to the realizations that whites were the problem and that they were never going to change unless they did something to take change to their own lives. Thank you for listening to One Mic. This is a Black History Podcast. If you enjoyed this and want to hear more about the events of the Red Summer, this is the topic of episode 3. Also, if you want to support this podcast, please consider donating to my Patreon page so we can keep this going. Also, listen to the Cut Podcast. We're doing amazing things. We'll bring you dope topics. Also, you can reach out to me on the Cut Podcast on Instagram, the Cut Podcast 1 on Twitter. Thank y'all for listening. Peace.